Hello to all of you. We will be discussing the anatomy questions for the subject wise test, and we will be today discussing from question number 101 to question number 120. Myself, Dr. Shilpi Agarwal. Now, first of all, we will go for the question number 101. The question number 101, it is talking about the atrioventricular groove. So, before starting that, we will just discuss the various grooves which are present in the heart. For the question 101, the answer is A. And if we talk about the various grooves which are present over here in this, if we see the anterior, if we view the heart from the anterior side, the anterior view, in the anterior view of the heart, the chambers which can be visualized over here, that is the chambers which are forming the anterior surface of the heart or the sternocostal surface, that includes the right atrium, right ventricle and the left ventricle. Now, the grooves which are present between these, the groove which is present between the right atrium and the right ventricle, this is known as atrioventricular groove. Also known as coronary sulcus. Now, this coronary sulcus, it is having two parts. In this, we say it is having anterior part and the posterior part. The anterior part of the coronary sulcus is the one which can be visualized from the anterior aspect. This is the anterior part of the coronary sulcus. For the posterior part, we will just visualize the heart from the posterior side. For the posterior view, in the posterior view, the whole of the left atrium can be visualized in the posterior view. The both left atrium and the right atrium, they are forming the base of the heart, and towards the inferior surface, we have the both ventricles, that is left and the right ventricles, which are resting on the diaphragm. Now, this portion over here, this is the portion, the posterior part of the coronary sulcus. This is the posterior part of the coronary sulcus and this is the anterior part of the coronary sulcus. Now, in this, we divide the in the anterior part, the structures which are running in the anterior part of the coronary sulcus, it includes the right coronary artery, as well as the small cardiac vein. Now, this is going towards the posterior side like this. These two structures, the right coronary artery and the small cardiac vein, we say they are running in the right portion of this anterior part of coronary sulcus. Towards the left portion, we have the one of the branch of left coronary artery, that is left circumflex artery, along with the great cardiac vein. They are towards the left side, in the left portion. These are the structures which are running in the anterior part of the coronary sulcus. Now, if we talk about the posterior portion or the posterior part of coronary sulcus, in this the coronary sinus is present. The coronary sinus is located over here. So, towards the posterior side, a large venous sinus is present over here, which is termed as coronary sinus, and it is present towards the posterior part of coronary sulcus. Now, next groove is the interventricular groove. Over here, in between the two ventricles, this is the interventricular groove. And again, it is having anterior and the posterior portions. This is the anterior part which can be seen from the anterior side, and when it goes posteriorly, this is the posterior part of the interventricular groove. So, if we talk about the structures running in this, for the interventricular groove, again it is having anterior part and the posterior part. Now the structures which are running in the anterior part, it includes one of the branch of the left coronary artery, that is the left interventricular artery, the left anterior interventricular artery. It is also known as the left anterior descending artery, and along with this, the vein which is present over here is the great cardiac vein. Towards the posterior side, in the posterior part of interventricular group, we have the posterior interventricular artery. And this posterior interventricular artery, it is a branch of right coronary artery. So these are the structures which are running in the various grooves which are present in the heart. This point over here, this is known as the crux of the heart, because this is the point where the interatrial groove as well as the atrioventricular groove and the interventricular groove, all these points are meeting at this point on the posterior side of the heart, known as the crux. Apart from this, if we talk about the apex of the heart is contributed by the left ventricle. And now if you go back to the question it says, true about the atrioventricular groove are all except. In this, the atrioventricular groove, it contains the left anterior descending coronary artery. This is wrong because it is present in the interventricular groove. Then B is, it is also known as coronary sulcus. Yes, it is correct. It contains right coronary artery, correct. And it contains a circumflex branch of left coronary artery, which is also correct, which we have discussed just now. So the answer for the question number 101 is A. Now for 102 question, torus aorticus. When we talk about the torus aorticus, this picture is showing the various sinuses of the ascending aorta. The aorta, it is having three sinuses. When we talk about the various sinuses which are present in the ascending aorta, one anterior aortic sinus, and there are two posterior aortic sinuses. The anterior aortic sinus, it is also known as right aortic sinus. And this anterior aortic sinus, it gives rise to the right coronary artery. The origin of right coronary artery, it takes place from here. The origin of right coronary artery. When we talk about the posterior aortic sinuses, we are having one left and right. The left posterior aortic sinus, it gives rise to, or the origin of the left coronary artery takes place from here. And this right posterior aortic sinus, it does not give rise to any of the coronary arteries, so it is also known as non-coronary sinus. And this non-coronary sinus, it is actually representing, or it is giving a bulge towards the interatrial septum of the right atrium, and that bulge, it gives to a small elevation when we see the right atrium from the inner aspect, and that elevation is known as torus aorticus. So elevation is raised due to this right posterior aortic sinus, and the elevation is seen in the right atrium, and that elevation is termed as torus aorticus. So over here in this picture we can see, this is the anterior aortic sinus over here. It is giving rise to the right coronary artery. Then towards the left posterior side, it is giving rise to the left coronary artery. And this one is the non-coronary sinus, which gives a bulge, torus aorticus. Now apart from the torus aorticus in the right atrium, the various other structures which are present, if you see the inner aspect of the right atrium, we have fossa ovalis, which is just present near the opening of the inferior vena cava. Then annulus ovalis is there. the annulus ovalis. So if you visualize the inner aspect of the right atrium, if this is in this, we have cut the anterior wall of the right atrium. This is the opening of superior vena cava and this is the opening of the inferior vena cava. The inferior vena cava, it is guarded by a rudimentary wall known as the eustachian valve. And just near this opening, a depression, oval depression is there, which is the fossa ovalis. This is the fossa ovalis. And at the margin of this fossa ovalis, this is the annulus ovalis. The third structure is crista terminalis. The crista terminalis is the portion which extends from the opening of this superior vena cava till this opening of inferior vena cava. A muscular ridge, it extends from here and termed as the crista terminalis. Apart from this, there is the opening of the coronary sinus. So we have the opening of coronary sinus. The coronary sinus, it is guarded by the trabeasin valve. Just below over here, there is the tricuspid valve, which will, through which the blood from the right atrium will go towards the right ventricle. So this is the opening of the tricuspid valve. Just above the opening of coronary sinus, over here, there is a bulging which is known as torus aorticus. Apart from this, another structure which is present in the right atrium is the triangle of Koch. And this triangle, it is formed over here. The boundaries, one of the boundaries formed by the opening of coronary sinus, another boundary is formed by the septal leaflet of tricuspid valve, and the third boundary over here, it is formed by the tendon of Trudaro. Within the triangle of Koch, the AV node is present, it is located in this triangle. And when we talk about the SA node, it is related or it is present in the upper portion of the crista terminalis. So these are the structures which are seen on the inner aspect of the right atrium. Now we come back to the question. The question says, the torus aorticus is seen due to. The answer for this question is, it is the C answer, the aortic sinus bulging into the right atrium. So for the question number 102, answer is C. Next question, question number 103, it is talking about the joint present between the epiphysis and diaphysis. The answer for this question is D, because this is a synchondrosis type of joint. The question number 103, when we talk about the joints are of three types. It is fibrous, cartilaginous and the synovial type of joint. The fibrous joint is there, then cartilaginous and the synovial. The fibrous joint, it includes sutures, syndesmosis and the gomphosis. The sutures, the various sutures which are present in the skull, it is serrate suture, denticulate suture, plain sutures and the squamous sutures are there, which are included in this. Apart from this, it also includes shin dialysis. The shin dialysis is formed between the vomer and the ala of the vomer and the rostrum of the sphenoid. So that is within the sutures. When we talk about the syndesmosis over here, the joints which are formed between the bones with the help of the interosseous membrane or the interosseous ligaments, and it typically includes the middle radioulnar joint and the middle tibiofibular joint. Apart from this, it is also including the inferior tibiofibular joint. When we talk about the gomphosis is the joint between the alveolar socket and the tooth. So over here, all these three subdivisions, they are included in the fibrous type of joints, because in this the two bones, they are connected with the help of the collagen fibers, or we say with the help of the ligaments or the membrane. Now when we come to the cartilaginous joints, it is subdivided into primary and the secondary cartilaginous joint. The primary, it is also known as synchondrosis, and secondary, it is also known as symphysis. For the synchondrosis, this type of joint, in this the cartilage piece is present between the two bones, and this cartilage will later on ossify and will convert into the bone, and this process is known as synostosis. So synostosis process is a characteristic feature of the synchondrosis type of joint, and the various examples or the location of this synchondrosis. The first example is at the level of the growth plate between the epiphysis and the diaphysis. The epiphyseal plate between epiphysis and diaphysis. So this is a joint between the epiphysis and diaphysis. Another example for this is first costosternal joint. And the third example is the joint between the basis sphenoid and basis occiput. So these are the three examples of the synchondrosis. Now when we talk about the symphysis, these joints, they are present to in the midline. And if you see this in the symphysis, we include the manubriosternal joint, the ziphysternal joint, pubic symphysis, and the joints between the vertebra at the level of the intervertebral disc. So all those joints are included in the symphysis. For the synovial is further divided into plane. It is divided into plane. Then other subdivisions are, the ball and socket is there, hinge variety is there, saddle, ellipsoid, pivot, and condylar. These are the subdivisions of the synovial joint. In the ball and socket, along with the hip and the shoulder joint, we also include the talocalcaneal joint and the joint which is formed between the incus and the stapes. For the hinge joint, in the hinge joint, we include the interphalangeal joints and the elbow joint. They are included in the hinge joint. Then for the saddle joint, we include the joint, the first carpometacarpal joint. Then it also includes the calcaneocuboid joint. And apart from this, the ankle joint is also included in this. The joint between the malleus and incus, that is also the saddle joint. For the ellipsoid, it includes the joint between the metacarpals and the carpal bones, that is the carpometacarpal joints over here, and the wrist joint, as well as the atlanto-occipital joint, which is between the base of the skull and the first cervical vertebra. The pivot joint, is between C1 and C2, atlanto-axial joint, then the superior radioulnar joint as well as the inferior radioulnar joint. The condylar joints, it includes the temporomandibular joints, knee joint, as well as the metacarpophalangeal joints. They are also included because structurally they are condylar type of joints. The knee joint, it is also termed as modified hinge, the modified hinge joint. Now over here, the question is specifically on synchondrosis, and it includes these three examples. The joint between the epiphysis and diaphysis is synchondrosis type. So question number 103, the answer for this question is D, synchondrosis. Now question number 104, the nutrient artery. For the question 104, when we talk about the nutrient artery, it is the artery which will be supplying the long bone. If this is the long bone, the nutrient artery, it comes or it enters through the nutrient foramen. This is the nutrient artery. And as it enters through the nutrient foramen, it divides into ascending and the descending branches. The ascending and descending branches, and they reach towards this metaphysis area. This is the metaphysis. Over here, we have the epiphyseal plate. This is the epiphysis, and this is the diaphysis portion. Now this artery, it reaches towards the metaphysis region, and when it comes over here, it will anastomose with the metaphyseal arteries, epiphyseal arteries and the periosteal arteries. And during this process, it will be supplying the inner two-thirds of the cortex of this diaphysis bone, as well as it is supplying the medullary cavity. Now this Newton artery, it is given by one of the major arteries which are present near to that bone. And if we talk about the Newton foramen, the direction of the Newton foramen is away from the growing bone, growing portion of that long bone. So in the upper limbs we say it is going away from the elbow. The Newton foramen, they are directed away from the elbow and they are directed towards the knee in the, they are directed towards the elbow in the upper limb and away from the knee in the lower limb. So if you go back to the question 104, the 104 question says the Newton artery runs. This artery is running towards the metaphysis. So the answer is A. And over there, as we have just talked about, it will be anastomosing with the rest of the arteries which will be supplying the long bone. The next question is question number 105. It talks about the traction epiphysis. Now the answer for this question is the B, the trochanter of the femur. This is the traction epiphysis. And if we talk about the rest of the epiphysis, for question number 105, we divide the epiphysis into four types. We have pressure epiphysis, traction epiphysis, atavistic epiphysis, and the aberrant epiphysis. For the pressure epiphysis, the pressure epiphysis are the portions of the long bone which are participating in the transmission of the weight, and it includes the head of humerus, then it includes the lower end of radius. Apart from this, it is including the head of femur and upper end of the tibia or the condyles of tibia. Then the next type of epiphysis is traction epiphysis. The traction epiphysis, these are the portions of the ends of the long bone which over where there will be pull of the muscles. So it includes greater and the lesser tubercles of humerus. As well as it will include the greater and the lesser trochanter of the femur. It also includes the mastoid process. Another type is the atavistic epiphysis. Atavistic epiphysis is the bones which were independent in the and during evolution, they fuse with a bone which is present nearby. So that means there is a change during the phylogeny or during the development, and it includes two examples. Specific two examples for this is coracoid process of scapula. The coracoid process of scapula, and it includes os trigonum. Os trigonum is the posterior tubercle of the talus. Fourth subtype is aberrant epiphysis. If the epiphysis is present at an abnormal location, we term it as aberrant epiphysis. When we talk about the metacarpals, in the metacarpals, we are having one epiphysis only for one end. So aberrant epiphysis, the example for this is at the head of first metacarpal. And the base of rest of the metacarpals. In the metacarpals, as I have just told, that only one epiphysis is present. The normal location of the epiphysis for the first metacarpal is base, and the normal location for the epiphysis for the rest of the metacarpals is head. So if the epiphysis is present at apart from these normal positions that will be included in the aberrant. So therefore in the aberrant we have included head of first metacarpal and base of the rest of the metacarpals. Now in this traction, the question is on the traction epiphysis. The traction epiphysis, it includes the greater and the lesser trochanter of the femur. So for question 105, the answer is B, that is the trochanter of the femur. Now question 106. The question number 106, first of all we will identify the various structures which are present over here. A structure which has been shown over here, this is a muscle and this muscle is scalenus anterior muscle. The scalenus anterior muscle, it is just lying anterior to the subclavian artery and it divides the subclavian artery into three parts, first, second and third. Apart from this, a nerve is running just anterior to this muscle, that is the phrenic nerve. Now this scalenus anterior muscle, it is attached to the first rib and it is attached to the scalene tubercle which is present on the inner aspect of the first rib. If you see, if this is the first rib on the inner aspect, we are having a scalene tubercle and this muscle is attached over here towards the scalene tubercle. Now just in front of the scalene tubercle and behind the scalene tubercle, we are having grooves which are for the respective vessels. Anterior to the scalene tubercle, we have subclavian groove and posteriorly we have the subclavian, the groove for the subclavian artery. Anterior one is the groove for the subclavian vein. So scalenus anterior, anterior to this, the subclavian vein is running and posterior to this, the subclavian artery is running. So anteriorly we have subclavian vein and posteriorly we have the subclavian artery. The B landmark over here, when we talk about the B landmark, it is the recurrent laryngeal nerve towards the left side. It is a left recurrent laryngeal nerve. As we can see over here, this left recurrent laryngeal nerve, it is winding around this arch of the aorta. The recurrent laryngeal nerve, it comes down towards the neck and only the left recurrent laryngeal nerve is the one which enters the superior mediastinum of the thorax. Then it winds around the arch of the aorta and it runs above, ascends above in the neck in the tracheoesophageal groove. If we talk about the right recurrent laryngeal nerve, it is present in the neck and it does not enter in the superior mediastinum. Within the neck only, it winds around the right subclavian artery and then again it will go above, run in the tracheoesophageal groove. Now this left recurrent laryngeal nerve, apart from its whole course, over here as it is winding around the arch of the aorta, it contributes into the deep cardiac plexus. Then the C structure which is present over here, the C structure is the left phrenic nerve. The root value is C3, C4 and C5. As we can visualize over here, this phrenic nerve starting from here, it is going like this. In the root, in the neck portion, it is running anterior to the scalenus anterior muscle. Then it enters the superior mediastinum of the thorax through the superior aperture. And as it comes in the mediastinum portion, it is running anterior to the hilum, or we say to the lung, to the root of the lung, and it is running in between the mediastinal pleura and the fibrous pericardium. Then it reaches towards the towards the diaphragm portion and it will be supplying the diaphragm as well as it is also supplying the pleura, pericardium and the peritoneum also. The another landmark, D. D over here, this is the artery which has been shown over here, which is going lower down like this. This is the internal thoracic artery. This is the internal thoracic artery and this internal thoracic artery, it is a branch of subclavian artery and it runs below, it is just lying at the either sides of the sternum in the parasternal region and it terminates into musculophrenic artery and the superior epigastric artery. and the superior epigastric artery. Now, when we talk about the branches of the subclavian artery, it is having three parts with the, and in the first part it is giving vertebral artery, the subclavian artery. When we talk about subclavian, it is having three parts. The first part it gives vertebral artery, then it gives internal thoracic artery as well as the thyrocervical trunk. The second part it gives costocervical trunk, and the third part it gives dorsal scapular artery. So these are the branches which are given by the subclavian artery. In this, the thyrocervical trunk, it further gives the suprascapular artery, the inferior thyroid artery, and as well as the transverse cervical artery. The costocervical trunk, it gives off deep cervical artery and the superior intercostal artery. So these are the branches of subclavian artery. Now in this, we have mentioned the deep cardiac plexus. So we should know regarding the cardiac plexus. When we talk about the cardiac plexus, there is superficial cardiac plexus and a deep cardiac plexus. The superficial cardiac plexus, it is present just inferior to the aortic arch in front of the pulmonary artery. And regarding the location of deep cardiac plexus, it is present posterior to the aortic arch and it is present just anterior to the tracheal bifurcation. Now the nerves which contribute into these respective plexus, for the superficial cardiac plexus, the two nerves which are specifically contributing into this is superior cervical cardiac branch and the inferior cardiac branch. Now this superior cervical cardiac branch, it is a branch of left superior cervical ganglion, and inferior cardiac branch, it is a branch of left vagus. These two branches, they contribute into the superficial cardiac plexus. The deep cardiac plexus, it is formed by all the cardiac branch. Apart from these two branches which are contributing into the superficial plexus, all the rest of the cardiac branches will be forming the deep cardiac plexus. Now for the deep cardiac plexus, it includes all the cardiac branches of the three cervical ganglia and the upper five thoracic ganglia. Apart from this, the cardiac branches of vagus and the recurrent laryngeal nerve. So apart from these two branches, all the cardiac branches coming from these cervical ganglion, the superior, middle and inferior cervical ganglion, and upper five thoracic ganglion, as well as the cardiac branches of vagus and the recurrent laryngeal, will all be included in the deep cardiac plexus. Now if you go back to the question, the question says we have to choose incorrect statement. So in the question number 106, in this, if we see that we have to choose the incorrect statement, as we have just discussed, A is the scalenus anterior muscle and it is separating the subclavian vein and the subclavian artery. So this is correct. B, recurrent laryngeal nerve of the left side, it is contributing into the deep cardiac plexus. This is also correct. C is phrenic nerve, which is sensory to the parietal pleura. This is also correct. And if we see the D option is internal thoracic artery, it originates from second part, which is wrong because it is originating from the first part, which we have just discussed. Now we come to the next question, the question number 107. First of all, we will see the various landmarks which are present over here. In this, the A landmark over here, this section is actually a transverse section which is taken at the level of the axilla, and the A muscle over here is the serratus anterior muscle. It is the serratus anterior muscle. The B, the muscle which has been shown over here, is the pectoralis minor. Then the D over here, this is the deltoid. And the C which is shown over here, this is the subscapularis muscle. This section is a section of the humerus, and over here this is the axilla, which is consisting of the various components or the contents of the axilla within this. Now if we talk about the nerve supply of all these muscles and regarding these muscles, first of all the subscapularis muscle, this is the one of the muscle of the rotator cuff. The rotator cuff, it is also known as musculotendinous cuff, and the four muscles which are included in this, they are sits. That includes supraspinatus, infraspinatus, then teres minor and the subscapularis muscle. These four muscles together, they are termed as a rotator cuff, which is surrounding this shoulder joint and it is providing strength to it. In this, the subscapular muscle, this muscle is termed as Fogarton muscle of the rotator cuff, of this rotator cuff. Now regarding the nerve supply of all these muscles, if we talk about the brachial plexus is having three cords, the medial cord, lateral cord and the posterior cord. The lateral cord is there, and then we have the posterior cord. Now this medial cord, it is giving five branches. It is giving medial cutaneous nerve of arm, medial cutaneous nerve of forearm, medial root of median nerve, then medial pectoral nerve and the ulnar nerve. So the medial pectoral nerve, it is given by this medial cord, and the ulnar nerve also is given by the medial cord. When we talk about the lateral cord, it gives off lateral pectoral nerve, the musculocutaneous nerve and the lateral root of median nerve. So therefore, the musculocutaneous, it is a branch of lateral cord as well as the lateral pectoral nerve. These are the branches of the lateral cord. When we talk about the posterior cord, the upper and the lower subscapular nerve, axillary nerve, radial nerve and the thoracodorsal nerve. These are the branches of the posterior cord. So we have subscapular nerve, the upper and lower. Then along with that, thoracodorsal nerve, axillary nerve, and the radial nerve. So these are the branches which are given by the various cords, by the various cords of the brachial plexus. Now if we talk about the muscles which are being supplied by this, for the medial pectoral nerve, the medial pectoral nerve and the lateral pectoral nerve together, they supply the pectoralis major. Apart from this, the medial pectoral nerve is also supplying the pectoralis minor muscle. Then for the ulnar nerve is supplying the two muscles of the forearm, that is flexor carpi ulnaris and the medial half of flexor digitorum profundus, and then it is supplying the majority of the muscles of the hand. If you talk about the musculocutaneous nerve, it is supplying the muscles of the anterior compartment of forearm, and it supplies the biceps, brachialis and the coracobrachialis. Now the median nerve is formed by the medial roots and the lateral root, which are coming from medial and the lateral cord, and the median nerve supplies the various muscles of the forearm, the anterior compartment of forearm, except the flexor carpi ulnaris and the medial half of digitorum profundus, and in the hand it is supplying the thenar group of muscles except the adductor pollicis and the first and it also supplies the first and the second lumbrical. Now, if we talk about the posterior cord is giving these branches. In this, the subscapular nerve, it supplies the subscapularis muscle. Then apart from this, the lower subscapular nerve is supplying the teres major. The thoracodorsal nerve, it is supplying the rhomboidus major and the minor muscles. The axillary nerve, it supplies the deltoid and teres minor. The radial nerve, it supplies all the muscles of the extensor compartment of arm and the extensor compartment of forearm. So, it supplies the triceps, anconius, supinator, brachioradialis and the rest of the extensor muscles. Now, these are the branches which are given from the brachial plexus. Now, there are some branches which are arising directly from the roots. The branches which directly arise from the roots, it includes the long thoracic nerve. It includes the long thoracic nerve and this nerve, it supplies the serratus anterior muscle. It is supplying the serratus anterior muscle. Now, if we go back to the question in this, now the question says that we have to mark the incorrect statement in this, we have to find the incorrect. The muscle A, that is the serratus anterior, is supplied by from a nerve from roots of brachial plexus. This is correct because it is supplied by the long thoracic nerve which directly arises from the roots. And the roots are C5, C6 and C7. The next is the muscle B, that is the pectoralis minor muscle. It is enclosed in clavipectoral fascia. The clavipectoral fascia is a deep fascia which is present just beneath the pectoralis major muscle and it encloses two muscles. The two muscles are pectoralis minor and the subclavius. So, this option is also correct. Muscle C, that is the subscapularis, it is referred as Fogarton muscle of the rotator cuff. So, this is also correct. When we come to the option D, the muscle B is pectoralis minor. It is supplied by the medial pectoral nerve, which is a branch of medial cord, and D muscle is deltoid muscle, which is supplied by axillary nerve, which is a branch of posterior cord. So, they are not from the same cord. So, this option is not correct. The answer for 107 is D. Then the question number 108 regarding the location of coronary sinus. Now, when we talk about the coronary sinus, the question is 108, coronary sinus. Now, this coronary sinus, it is located in the posterior part of coronary sulcus. It is located in the posterior part of coronary sulcus. The coronary sulcus is present between the atrium, which are present above, and the ventricles, which are present below. If you visualize the heart from the posterior side, this is the posterior view. If this is the left atrium, the right atrium, the left ventricle and the right ventricle, then the sulcus which is present over here, this sulcus is the coronary sulcus and this is the posterior part of the coronary sulcus. A large venous sinus is present over here, which is the coronary sinus. So, this is the location of the coronary sinus. Now, the various veins of the heart, they are draining into the coronary sinus. So, the tributaries of coronary sinus, it includes the tributaries, it includes the small cardiac vein, the great cardiac vein, middle cardiac vein, and apart from this, oblique vein of left atrium. And the posterior vein of left ventricle. These are the veins which are directly draining into the coronary sinus and only one vein is there, that is the anterior cardiac vein, which does not open into the coronary sinus, but it directly opens into the right atrium. So, these tributaries, they open up into the coronary sinus, and the coronary sinus then finally will drain into the or will open into the right atrium. Only the anterior cardiac vein is the one. The anterior cardiac vein, it directly opens into the right atrium. Now, apart from these veins which are present for the heart, we also have Thebesian veins. The Thebesian veins, they are also termed as venae cordis minimae. These are the small multiple veins which are present within the substance of the wall of the heart, and they are present in all the chambers, and they will open up into the cavities or into the chambers which are present just nearby. So, the ones which are present in the atrium will open into the atrium, and the ones which are present in the ventricle will open directly into those ventricles. Now, if you come back to the question says, the coronary sinus, the answer for this question, first of all, A option says it lies in the anterior part. No, it is not lying in the anterior part. It actually lies in the posterior part of the coronary sulcus. Coronary sinus, B option, and ends in the right atrium. This is correct. C, it has venae cordis minimae as its tributaries. It does not have them as tributaries. The venae cordae minimae, they open directly into the chambers. D, it develops from right anterior cardinal vein. It does not develop from the right anterior cardinal vein. When we talk about the development of coronary sinus, the coronary sinus, it develops from the left horn of sinus venosus. The left horn of sinus venosus, it leads to the formation of the coronary sinus. And as the option is mentioning the anterior cardinal vein, the common cardinal vein of the right side as well as the right anterior cardinal veins, they give rise to the superior vena cava and the brachiocephalic vein. So, the answer for this question is, the answer for this question 108 is B. The next question, it is regarding the clavicle. When we talk about the clavicle, when we talk regarding the clavicle is the only long bone which is lying horizontally over here. Apart from this, it is not having the medullary cavity. Then this is a subcutaneous bone, and it is having only one primary center of ossification. So, one primary center of ossification is there. If we talk about the ossification, it ossifies in membrane. It ossifies in the membrane except its medial end. The medial end, it is the cartilaginous portion, and it is ossifying by the endochondral ossification. The rest of the bone is ossifying by the membranous ossification. Then apart from this, occasionally this bone is pierced by the middle supraclavicular nerve. And if we talk about the most common site of fracture, if this is the clavicle, if this is the medial end or the medial side, and this is the lateral side, the most common site of fracture will be at the junction of medial two-third. This is the medial two-third and lateral one-third. This is the point of common site of fracture in the clavicle, that is at the junction of medial two-third and the lateral one-third. Now, regarding this clavicle, only one more characteristic is there regarding the clavicle. This is the bone which is first to start ossifying, that is at around 5th to 6th week of intrauterine life, and this is the one which is last to complete the ossification by the 25 years of life. So, in this question, if we see, the question says, what is false regarding the clavicle? First is A option is it ossifies in membrane. This is correct. It is horizontal bone. C is also correct. In this, the answer is D, because the most common site is the medial two-third, the junction of medial two-third and the lateral one-third. The next question, it talks about the attachment of the coracoid process of scapula. Question 110. When we talk about the scapula, if this is a scapula portion, this portion is a glenoid cavity, and towards the posterior side we are having this acromion process, and this is the spine of scapula, and towards the superior border we are having the coracoid process. This is the acromion process, this is the spine of scapula, this is the coracoid process. Then this is the glenoid cavity. Just above the glenoid cavity, we are having a tubercle, supraglenoid tubercle. This is supraglenoid tubercle, and just below it, we are having the infraglenoid tubercle. Now, the various muscles which are attached to all these structures, the various landmarks, when we talk about the coracoid process is giving attachment to three muscles. And those muscles are the coracobrachialis, then it gives attachment to short head of biceps, apart from this it gives attachment to the pectoralis minor muscle. In this first and second muscle, they are specifically attached to the tip of the coracoid process. The supraglenoid tubercle, this supraglenoid tubercle, it gives attachment to the long head of biceps, and the infraglenoid tubercle, it gives attachment to the long head of triceps. The rest of the two heads, that is the lateral and the medial head of triceps, they arise from the posterior aspect of the humerus above and below the spiral groove. Now, if we come back to the question, it is talking about the coracoid process. It says all the following muscles are attached to the coracoid process of scapula, except in this the answer will be D, that is the long head of triceps, because the long head of triceps, it is attached to the infraglenoid tubercle. Now, question number 111, it talks about the rectus sheath. So, first of all, we will discuss the rectus sheath. Question number 111 regarding the rectus sheath. Now, the rectus sheath, it is a sheath which is formed around the rectus abdominis muscle, and it is having an anterior wall and the posterior wall, and it is mainly contributed by the aponeurosis of external oblique, internal oblique and the transversus abdominis muscle. Now, there is a difference. There is a difference in the covering or in the anterior and the posterior walls of the rectus sheath above and below. If we talk about this, there is a difference when we talk about above the costal margin. Then between costal margin and arcuate line. And the third is below arcuate line. This arcuate line, it is lying at the level of the anterior superior iliac spine. So, over there in this question, they are actually talking about the arcuate line. Now, first of all, we will discuss regarding this portion, that is the middle portion, and this is the main portion of the rectus sheath. How it is formed by the aponeurosis? It is formed around the rectus abdominis muscle. If this is the cut section of rectus abdominis muscle, the rectus abdominis muscle, this is the rectus abdominis muscle. Now, This is external oblique. It covers the whole of the anterior aspect, then it goes medially. Then just below that we are having the internal oblique muscle. This is internal oblique. The internal oblique, as it comes towards the lateral border of the rectus abdominis, it divides into two lamina, anterior lamina and the posterior lamina. Just deep to this we have the transversus abdominis muscle. This is transversus abdominis and it contributes towards the posterior side. Most posteriorly, over here we are having a fascia which is fascia transversalis. Now this is a section which is taken at this level, and in this we can see the anterior wall. The anterior wall is formed by the epididosis of external oblique and the internal oblique. In the internal oblique, the anterior lamina is contributing to its anterior wall. The posterior wall is formed by, this is the posterior wall of the rectus sheath. It is formed by the posterior lamina of epididosis of internal oblique and the transversus abdominis epididosis. Now if we go above it, towards the upper aspect, the external oblique epididosis is the one which is completely forming the anterior wall, and it is contributed by internal oblique as well as the transversus abdominis, and the posterior wall is deficient because it is resting on the costal cartilages. So towards the posterior side, towards the posterior wall is deficient and it is resting on the costal cartilage. Below the arcuate line, if you take the same section, this is the rectus abdominis muscle. We have the external oblique muscle, the epididosis, it goes and forms the anterior wall. Then for the internal oblique, this is the internal oblique, this also goes towards the anterior side completely to form the anterior wall of the rectus sheath, and the transversus abdominis also, it goes also towards the anterior side to form the anterior wall of the rectus sheath. So all the three muscles, they contribute in the formation of the anterior wall of the rectus sheath when we see it just below the arcuate line. And the posterior wall is formed by the fascia transversalis. So the posterior wall of the sheath, of this rectus sheath over here, it is formed by fascia transversalis. So this is a difference in the rectus sheath. And the various contents which are present within the rectus sheath, it includes the rectus abdominis muscle. Apart from that, it includes the pyramidalis also. Then it includes the superior epigastric vessels and the inferior epigastric vessels and the lower six thoracic nerves. So now if we come back to the question, it says, question number 111, the posterior wall of rectus sheath below the level of anterior superiliac spine or below the arcuate level, it will be formed by fascia transversalis. So the answer for this question is D. Next question, the celiac plexus. Question number 112 regarding the celiac plexus. The celiac plexus, it gets parasympathetic branches and the sympathetic branches. The sympathetic supply or the sympathetic branches, they are coming from the greater and the lesser splanchnic nerve. And the parasympathetic branches to this plexus, it is coming from the vagus. So the question says, which nerve supplies the celiac plexus? So it will be, the answer for this question will be B, because the greater and the lesser splanchnic nerve, they contribute to the celiac plexus. So the answer is B. The question number 113, it talks about the pelvic diaphragm. The answer for this question is levator ani, which is actually forming the pelvic diaphragm. If we talk about the pelvic diaphragm, the pelvic diaphragm, it is made up of two muscles, and that is levator ani and ischiococcygeus muscle. The ischiococcygeus muscle, it is also termed as coccygeus muscle. The levator and eye in turn is having the various components. It includes pubococcygeus as well as iliococcygeus. Apart from this, it also includes puborectalis muscle, which forms a sling, a U-shaped sling around the anorectal junction to prevent the continence or provide continence to the rectum. Then it also includes puboanalis, pubovaginalis or puboprostaticus. And puboperinealis. All these are the components of the levator and eye. These two muscles together, levator and eye and the ischiococcygeus, they are covering the whole of the pelvic outlet and they are providing support to the various openings of the viscerals which are present within the pelvic cavity. That is the urethral opening, vaginal opening and the anal opening. The levator and eye, it is towards the anterior two-third portion of the perineal area. And the posterior one-third portion, the ischiococcygeus is there, which will be forming the pelvic diaphragm. So, question number 113, the answer will be C, levator and eye. Now, we come to the question number 114. In this, first of all, we will see the various structures which has been marked over here. So, for the question number 114. The structure A which has been marked over here, the structure A is the lingual nerve. The structure A is the lingual nerve. The structure B over here is the inferior alveolar nerve. The structure C is cauda tympani nerve. A thin nerve can be seen over here. This is cauda tympani nerve. This cauda tympani nerve, this is a branch of facial nerve. The lingual nerve and the inferior alveolar nerve, these are the branches of the mandibular nerve. The D structure which has been shown over here, this is the auriculotemporal nerve. Now, in this, the lingual nerve, inferior alveolar nerve and the auriculotemporal nerve, these are the branches of posterior division of mandibular nerve. So, if we talk about the mandibular nerve, it is one of the divisions of the trigeminal nerve and the branches which are given by this, by the trunk. The trunk gives a branch, a meningeal branch, which is termed as nervus spinosus. Then it gives a branch to medial pterygoid. A branch to the medial pterygoid. Then this trunk, it divides into the anterior and the posterior division. The posterior division, it gives off these three branches, that is auriculotemporal nerve, then the lingual nerve and inferior alveolar nerve. These three branches are given by the posterior division. Then from the anterior division, it gives branch to the lateral pterygoid. Then mesenteric branch is given, which will supply the masseter muscle. The mesenteric nerve is given. Then a branch to the temporalis muscle. The deep temporal nerve or the temporal branch, and apart from this, it is giving a buccal nerve. A buccal nerve is given. Now, this buccal nerve, as it reaches, this buccal nerve is a sensory nerve, and in this, if you see, this is the sensory nerve, and these three branches, these are given to the various muscles of the mastication. Now, specifically, if we talk about the branches of posterior divisions, we have auriculotemporal nerve. The auriculotemporal nerve, it gives branches or the secretomotor fibers to the parotid gland. The postganglionic secretomotor or the parasympathetic fibers, they arise from the otic ganglion and then they pass through this auriculotemporal nerve to the parotid gland for the secretions of the parotid gland, and the salivary secretions are formed. Apart from this, it is giving sensory supply also, and it gives sensory supply to the temporomandibular joint, to the temporomandibular joint and the upper parts of ear pinna. Upper parts of ear pinna, external acoustic meatus and the tympanic membrane. The upper portions of these structures, these are supplied by the auriculotemporal nerve. The lower portion of the ear pinna and the lower portion of rest of these structures, they are supplied by the greater auricular nerve and the auricular branch of vagus nerve. Now, if you talk about the lingual nerve, it is giving sensory supply to the anterior two-third of the tongue and it is carrying the general sensations from there. Apart from this, it will be supplying the submandibular and the sublingual glands. This lingual nerve, it is connected by the cauda tympani nerve, which is a branch of the facial nerve. The fibers, these are the preganglionic parasympathetic fibers, which are coming over here into the lingual nerve and then they reach towards the submandibular ganglia. And they are distributed to the postganglionic fibers, they are distributed to the submandibular and the sublingual glands for the salivary secretion, for the secretomotor function. Now, for the inferior alveolar nerve, when we talk about the inferior alveolar nerve, it enters the mandibular foramen on the inner aspect of the mandible, and before entering it, it gives a nerve to myelohyoid, which will be supplying the myelohyoid muscle. Then as it enters the mandibular foramen, it will be supplying the lower gums and the lower tooth. It will be supplying molars and the premolars. Then after that, it gives an incisive branch. The incisive branch supplies the incisors and the canines of the lower jaw. And then it gives a mental branch. The mental branch, it comes out through the mental foramen, which is present on the outer aspect of the mandible. It supplies the skin and the skin of the lower lip. So these are the various structures. Now, if you come back to the question says, we have to choose the correct option. In this, it says that A, that is the lingual nerve, pierces the buccinator muscle. This is not wrong because the buccinator muscle is actually pierced by a branch of the facial nerve when it is supplying it. So this option is not correct. Then B gives off the posterior superior alveolar nerve. B is the inferior alveolar nerve. It does not give rise to posterior superior alveolar nerve. The posterior superior alveolar nerve is a branch of the maxillary nerve. C, the cauda tympani is secretomotor to sublingual and submandibular gland. This we have just discussed and this is correct, that the cauda tympani nerve, it is carrying preganglionic parasympathetic fibers which are coming from the superior salivary nucleus and then they enter the lingual nerve and then towards the submandibular ganglion. So this statement is correct. D option says auriculotemporal nerve, it supplies temporomandibular joint and lobule of the ear. Lobule of the ear is the lower portion of the ear, which is actually supplied by the greater auricular nerve. So in this, for the question number 114, the answer will be C. If we talk about the maxillary nerve is the one which is giving the branches are the zygomatic nerve, then it gives the anterior, middle and the posterior superior alveolar nerves. And then the maxillary nerve, it continues as the infraorbital nerve. Now, the next question, 115. For this 115 question, the structures, we will identify the structures. Now, this is a picture of the spinal cord. We have to decide the ventral and the dorsal end of the spinal cord. For the spinal cord, the arteries which are supplying the spinal cord, it includes the anterior spinal artery and the posterior spinal artery. We have one anterior spinal artery and two posterior spinal arteries. So that means on the ventral aspect of the spinal cord, we can visualize only one artery which is running in the middle. Because we have one anterior spinal artery and towards the dorsal side, we will be able to visualize two spinal arteries. Then this anterior spinal artery, it supplies the anterior two-third of spinal cord And the posterior spinal artery, it supplies the posterior one third. These two, the spinal artery, anterior and posterior, these two are the branches of the vertebral artery. The vertebral artery, apart from giving these two branches, it also gives another branch, which is spica, posterior inferior cerebellar artery. So these two are the branches of vertebral artery. The vertebral artery, it gives off the branches which includes anterior spinal artery, posterior spinal artery, and apart from this, spica. The spica is there. Now, there are certain syndromes which occur due to the occlusion of the branches of these vertebral arteries. If there is occlusion of anterior spinal artery, then this leads to medial medullary syndrome. And this syndrome is also known as degerence syndrome. So there is occlusion of anterior spinal artery in this case, in the medial medullary syndrome or degerence syndrome. If there is occlusion of spica, it leads to lateral medullary syndrome. It leads to lateral medullary syndrome, also known as Wallenberg syndrome. Also known as Wallenberg syndrome. Now, we just come back to this picture now and we try to identify the structures. Over here, we can visualize single artery which is present over here. So, that means this is the ventral aspect of the spinal cord. The D is anterior spinal artery. Over here, B structure, this is one of the radicular branch which is given off by this anterior spinal artery. The radicular branch of anterior spinal artery. C over here, these are the ventral roots of the spinal nerve, the ventral roots which are coming from this specific spinal segment, the ventral root of spinal nerve. Then A structure, which is shown over here, the A structure is the ligamentum denticulatum, the ligamentum denticulatum or the denticulate ligament, which are actually the extension of the pia mater. These are the extensions of pia mater. And these are tooth-like projections which are extending towards the side. If you see over here, these are the tooth-like projections like this. And these are extending towards the side. And on the lateral aspect, they will be attached to the dura mater. So basically, they are holding the whole of the spinal cord in place, as well as it is clinically helpful because if you want to approach approach a certain tract, then we can go anterior or posterior to this ligamentum denticulatum. Now, apart from this extension of the pia mater, there is one more extension of the pia mater, that is the phylum terminal, which comes at the end of the spinal cord, and that phylum terminal, it extends till the coccyx region. We come back to the question. The question says that we have to choose the correct option. In the correct option, the A is the ligamentum denticulatum. It is a modification of the pia mater. So this option is not correct. B is a radicular branch of anterior spinal artery. So this is also not correct. C is the ventral root. So this is also not correct. Occlusion of D, that is the anterior spinal artery, it leads to the degerence syndrome or the medial medullary syndrome. So the for this question, the answer is D, 115 question. Now we go to the next question. It says that violent inversion of the foot will lead to avulsion of which tendon, which is attached to the tuberosity of the fifth metatarsal. So if there is violent inversion means that the medial border of the foot is raised violently. So in this, what will happen towards the lateral border, the most lateral most muscle, which is actually attached to the fifth metatarsal, base of fifth metatarsal, that will be involved, and the avulsion of that tendon will be there. Now in this, if we see the various tendons which I mentioned over here, for this we will just discuss. Question number 116. If you see the various options which have been mentioned over here, they have mentioned the tendons peroneus longus, peroneus brevis, and the peroneus tertius. Now, this peroneus longus muscle, this muscle is inserted at the base of first metatarsal, and along with that, the fibers, they are going towards the medial cuneiform also. The peroneus brevis, it is attached to the base of fifth metatarsal, and that too towards the lateral aspect. When we talk about the peroneus tertius, it is attached to the medial aspect of base of fifth metatarsal, and the extensor digitorum brevis, this muscle is attached to the rest of the toes, that is to the second, third, fourth and fifth toes. And it is basically going to the to these toes, and it will be attached to the phalanges. So now in this, if we see, the peroneus brevis is the muscle which is the lateral most muscle. It is attached to the lateral aspect of the base of fifth metatarsal, or we say towards the tuberosity of this base of fifth metatarsal. And this is the muscle which will be avulsed during the forced inversion movement. So for the question number 116, the answer will be peroneus brevis, that is the option A. The next question is question number 117. The primitive streak, the initiation and the maintenance of primitive streak is due to the nodal gene. And when this nodal gene appears, only after that the rest of the things, the mesoderms or the right and the left side laterality or the cranial and the caudal side, that will be decided. Question number 117 and question 118, they talk about the primitive streak. For the primitive streak, when we visualize the embryonic disc from the dorsal side, for the dorsal view of embryonic disc, in this we can visualize the primitive streak. Towards the cranial side, we have the buccopharyngeal membrane, or we say the procaudal plate is present over here. The procaudal plate, this is formed by the hypoblast cells. The hypoblast cells, they change the shape from cuboidal to columnar, and this procaudal plate, it decides the cranial end of the embryo. Towards the most caudal side, we are having the cloacal membrane. Just in front of this, the primitive streak is there, and it is having towards its cranial side the primitive node. This is primitive node, also termed as Hansen's node. And this is a primitive streak. Within the primitive streak, over here we have a primitive groove, a depression which is present over here. The primitive groove is there, And within the primitive node over here, we have a depression, which is the primitive pit. In front of this, the notochord is present, which extends from this primitive node till the procaudal plate. The primitive streak, it is formed by the proliferation of the epiblast cells. So this is formed by the epiblast cells. And after the formation of primitive streak by the epiblast cell, it will lead to the formation of the three germ layers, that is, a process of gastrulation will begin, as well as it contributes in the formation of the notochord. So that means the notochord, the primitive streak, as well as all the three germ layers, they are derived from the epiblast. And for the maintenance and the initiation of this primitive streak, we require the nodal gene. And this primitive streak, it will later on help in the gastrulation process and the formation of the notochord. In the gastrulation process, all the three germ layers are formed, and the first layer to be formed is the endoderm layer. So if you come back to the question, says for the 117 question, the answer is C, nodal gene. And for the question number 118, the indicator of start of gastrulation is by the formation of the primitive streak. So for the 118 question, the answer is C, because once the primitive streak is formed, the epiblast cells, they proliferate and they pass through this primitive groove and the primitive pit, and it passes deep to this epiblast layer. And this layer, now these cells will form the mesoderm. The epiblast cells, they will go towards the hypoblast layer and will replace those cells to form the endodermal layer. And then the rest of the epiblast cells which are left, they will lead to the formation of the ectoderm. So therefore, the gastrulation process is by the initially it is by the formation of the primitive streak, and this process, it occurs in the third week of the intrauterine life. And the first layer which is formed is endoderm. After that, mesoderm is formed, and the last layer to be formed is the ectoderm. The next question, number 119, is regarding the supinator jerk. The root value of the supinator jerk is C5C6. And when we talk about the supinator jerk, we are actually hitting the brachioradialis muscle. The brachioradialis muscle is a muscle which causes supination when it is in the mid prone position. So for the supinator jerk, we put the forearm in the mid prone position, and then we hit the brachioradialis muscle in the lower end, towards the lower end over here. And when it is hit over here, if this root value is intact, or we say this brachioradialis muscle, which is supplied by the radial nerve, if the radial nerve is intact, this supinator jerk will be normal, and there will be sudden supination as well as the radial deviation of the at the level of the wrist joint. So this supinator jerk, the root value is C5 C6. This is the root value. And then the muscle which is tested is the brachioradialis. And by this jerk, the nerve which we are actually testing is the radial nerve, the supinator jerk. Then apart from this, there are other jerks which are present or which are used are biceps jerk is there. The root value of biceps jerk again is C5 and C6. And in this, we hit the tendon of the biceps, and this is to check the musculocutaneous nerve. Third is the triceps jerk. The root value is C6 and the C7. Over here, the triceps muscle, the tendon of triceps muscles is hit, and over here also we are checking the radial nerve. Then there is one more jerk, knee jerk. For the knee jerk, the root value is L2, L3 and L4, and in this we are hitting the tendon of quadriceps, the quadriceps femoris muscle, and the nerve which is tested is femoral nerve. Fifth jerk is the ankle jerk. The root value for this is S1, and we are basically hitting the tendon of gastrocnemius muscle, and we are checking the tibial nerve for this. So these are the other various jerks which are present or which are used, and the root values of those jerks. Now, if you come back to the question says a supinator jerk, the root value of supinator jerk, the answer will be C, that is C5 and C6. The next question is regarding the deltoid muscle. For the deltoid muscle, question number 120. The deltoid muscle, it is a muscle of the shoulder and it is having a wide origin. It is taking origin from the clavicle as well as it is taking origin from acromion process and the spine of scapula. And insertion is, it is all the fibers, they are commonly getting inserted to the deltoid tuberosity of the humerus. And this is a muscle which is a multipinnate muscle. Then we divide the muscle into three components. It is having anterior fibers, middle fibers and the posterior fibers. Now these fibers, they are arising from the different areas. The anterior fibers, they are arising from the clavicle. The middle fibers, they are specifically arising from the acromion process of scapula, and the posterior fibers, they are arising from the spine of the scapula. Now, all these three fibers, because of their different directions and they are converging at same point, deltoid tuberosity, they are having different actions. The anterior fibers, they help in flexion and the medial rotation. The middle fibers, when they contract, they help in the abduction of the shoulder. And the posterior fibers, they help in extension and the lateral rotation. The nerve supply of this muscle is axillary nerve. And if we talk about the abduction is basically carried about by four muscles. Supraspinatus helps in the initiation, then till the 90 degree by deltoid, and above the 90 degree is by serratus anterior and the trapezius. So now if you see, the question is regarding the action of these muscles. The deltoid muscle, it causes all except, the answer will be D in this case, because it does not cause adduction, it will be causing the abduction movement. And the rest of the movements, flexion, extension, internal rotation as well as the external rotation, will be by the deltoid. So this is till question number 120. Thank you.